two people. So as long as there's, and if there's too few laptops, you can use mine. And if there's still too few laptops, then we can have three people every now and then. So if anyone is wondering what's going on here, it's the Coding Dojo. And we've got 5 minutes before we start. So for those of you who are showing up, I think this, if you're a programmer who haven't done massive amounts of test room development before, I think this is probably going to be the most useful session that you go to on the whole conference. If you're programmers who's done massive amounts of test-driven development before, it's still going to be fun. See if you get it with them, and then we'll switch if the network helps us out. A little bit of time before we're starting. I'm just testing out the thingamabob. Right. Good enough. I think it will not be a big crowd this time, so I think this will probably be mostly superfluous. Come again? Ah. Probably better. Yeah. Can we have this mic on as well? That's a good point. Did you get the slides? Yep. All right, I think we'll get started. So first, I'd like to ask you guys to move a bit closer to the stage. So coding dojo like this works best when there's a little bit of buzz going on in the room. It works best when there's a small crowd, so you guys will get much more out of it than if there were many more people here. So that's good. Good for you guys anyway, not so good for the people outside. All right, so first question. Who here has written code in the last month? Okay, in the last year? All right, so you might... You'll be watching, all right.
I wrote last 10 years back.
Oh, that's interesting. You'll also be a little bit more passive, so we'll see how that will work out for you. All right, welcome. Come in. Sit in the front. Okay, to get started, welcome to the Coding Dojo. My name is Johannes, and with me here I've got Buddhima, who will help me help you and also help me demonstrate how to do test-driven development and pair programming. So this is a hands-on session. I hope that at least half of you brought computers, and it looks like it from an informal count. And I hope that you have a development environment that you're comfortable with on those computers. We'll get into that. So I'll give a little bit of an introduction of what a coding dojo is. Come in, you haven't missed anything. Come forward, because I need everybody to be gathered closely together. So we'll talk a little bit about what a coding dojo is while people are arriving. I will show together with Buddhima what ping pong programming looks like. Then you will get to do a programming exercise. And then we might repeat that exercise, because it's through repetition that we really learn. And then we won't have time for a second round. But if we had more time, we would do a second round. So a coding dojo is a place where programmers come together to practice in a group of people. So this is an example from our first code retreat in Sri Lanka, which is one type of coding dojo. So that's the people. The second part is the practice. So this is an example from Kiev in Ukraine, where I gave a coding dojo 2 years back. And what people are doing on the picture is what we call deliberate practice, which is to practice with a purpose of learning. And that is really how you become an expert at your craft, is by slowing down and repeating what you do many times and reflect on different ways of doing it. So that's what we'll have the chance to do. And we do it in a social setting. Part of it is because one of the most important practices we'll be working on is pair programming. And the scary part of pair programming, the difficult part of pair programming, is to be comfortable programming in a social setting. So that's why we've got the other people here. And that is a very good way to improve, but it takes some time getting used to. But also, it's a good way to get to know new people and to have more fun working together. So it's more fun to work together than to work alone. Here's another picture from a coding dojo in Oslo, and it contains, sort of to wrap up, it contains the most important elements of a coding dojo. It has code, it has programmers, and it has beer. But we won't be having beer this time around, I'm afraid. If you guys are very interested, we might drag it into the evening and maybe get some beer in the bar. This is ping pong programming. You have two people, so it's pair programming. You have test room development, which means we write a test, we make it pass, we write a test, we make it pass. You have refactoring, so when we've made a test pass, we'll improve the code. And we put it all together. So I will write a failing test, and Buddhima will make it pass. He'll write a failing test, and I'll make it pass. So that's the ping pong part of it. And it's a very good way to practice how to share the keyboard together. Pair programming doesn't necessarily work like that when you're doing it full time. It's not necessarily as a rigorous sharing, but it's a very good way to practice. And then we do refactoring when the code is green. So, Buddhima, shall we get started? The problem we'll be working on is calculating leap years. And do you have your environment ready?
Yes, I do.
All right. So we'll switch to Buddhima's computer. We will be working with C# and Visual Studio, but these skills are independent of programming language. So while Buddhima is setting up here, or maybe it goes very fast. Yes. All right, so that was a bit unclear. Shall we increase the font? Probably won't be enough. All right, so Buddhima is changing the background color and increasing the font. So first, who here thinks of themselves as a programmer? All right, so there's a few of you who didn't raise your hands. So who didn't raise their hand? All right, So do you guys have experience programming before? Yes. All right. So you will probably have a more passive role in your pair, or you might be observing another pair. For those of you who are programmers, so what's your programming language?
JavaScript.
Your preferred programming language, JavaScript. Do you have a setup with a testing environment for it? All right. So we'll have to work on that a little bit. And the network here is slow, so that's, you have Node and NPM installed?
I have
Node. NPM, Node Package Manager. Right. So you can already now, you can do NPM install minus G mocker. So that goes for other JavaScript programmers as well. So who's the JavaScript programmer? You're the only one, I think. All right. So what's your favorite programming language? You would use Java? And what programming tool do you have? Good. Eclipse is very easy to get started with. Who else uses Java? You use Eclipse as well? Yes. Do you guys know each other? Great. Okay. And your programming language?
C
sharp? All right. Who else uses C sharp? All right. And you, sir?
Ruby.
Do you have an environment with the tests framework set up? Good. Anyone else using Ruby? You're using your Ruby. Great. Okay, so what programming languages have we missed? So, user, which?
Right.
Right, so you probably will be comfortable with a C-sharp developer or a Java developer, I think. Not so much with a JavaScript developer. So did you get it set up? It isn't, but if we increase the font, I think it'll be okay. Right. Okay, so I think you're starting with the NPM thing. So, okay, so shall we just get started? All right, do you want to write the first test?
Yes.
So the problem we're working on is calculating leap years. So which years are leap years? Does anyone know? Years that are divisible by 4 are leap years. Good. Come again? And not 100, except 400. Yes. So there is. So what's an example of what's a good example to start with? So what's a good example year to write the first test for? 100. Well, when you go before 1600, everything gets weird. So we're not probably not going to move there. Any other suggestions?
2000.
And is 2000 a leap year or not? It is, but it isn't, but it is. So it is an example that covers all the special cases. So I don't think it's a good place to start, but it's probably a good place to end. All right, what's a simpler place to start? 1999, I like that. So that's not a leap year. All right, so 1999 is not a leap year?
And our function should return false, I guess.
Yeah, that's good. 1999? Come again? Mocha, M-O-C-H-A. All right, so we call the method is leap year. Yeah, sure. So new leap year calculator, good. Nice. We'll just leave it there for now, and then we can move it later. That's good. Can we get this mic turned on?
It could be 1999.
So that returns a boolean, I guess.
Yes, we'll change that.
See.
Yeah, could the method, it will return a boolean, and this would be the year.
Yeah, that's good.
So I will write the assertion here to should be
false. Good.
I will run the test now.
All right, so the test is failing. And then I will take over, and I'll make the test pass. So what's the simplest thing that would possibly work?
Return false.
Return false. Good. So that makes the test pass. Thank you. All right, any refactorings?
Yes, I think we can move the initiation code to the
So we move the initiation code to the class level, refactoring, I think that's introduce field.
Yes.
I'll do it like this. All right. I think that's enough for now. Mm. And what's a good next test case, Buddhima?
So we can try something with a leap year, I guess.
Mm-hmm. So 2012? 2012 should be true. I run it, and it fails.
Okay.
All right, I think we forgot a step, and I'll have to catch up later. Okay, you. So what's the simplest thing that could possibly work now? Put an else, maybe, yeah?
So
yeah. It's, yeah?
First scenario would be to be divided by 4, I guess.
Yeah, I think we can just say if the number is divisible by 4, then we return true.
Yes. Run the test.
All right, and I forgot an important step. High five. That's an important step of ping pong programming.
Okay, we'll see. So what would be our next test?
So does anyone remember the next exception case? Come again? Now that's, I think we're outside of the range of reasonable expectation. I think we're going to focus on the modern years. 2000, yes. Is 2000 a leap year or not? Yes. What will the code do now if we try it for 2000? It's a special case, yeah. So there's a simpler special case. I think 2100 would be a good example, because since 2100 is not divisible by 100, it is divisible by 100, then it should not be a leap year.
Yes.
Sometimes you wish that the Earth was just a little bit more well-behaved going around the sun.
So it should be false, I guess.
Yes, that seems correct.
The test and see.
All right. And now I see something here that looks very similar to what I like, so I'll just use the copy paste design pattern. And yeah,
high five.
All right, and now comes your case with 2000, I think. So 2000 is a leap year because it is divisible by 400. So please go ahead.
So in our case, so we had to divide it by 400.
Yes.
And in that case, it should be a
could be just like these
true.
Two.
Yeah. We'll copy that and say 400 and it should be true.
High five.
Yeah.
All right. So that is the leap year calculator cutting. It is a very simple example. and we use it to demonstrate the back and forth, the red-green cycle. When is a good time for refactoring, and the kind of discussions that we have among ourselves and also including you guys. So what do you guys think? Does this look easy or difficult? Easy? All right, so... Yes, it's running all the four test cases here in the test runner. So here they are. Yes, a very, very good point. So the strength of our tests, so this would be a very reasonable error to introduce there. And now a test should fail. Yes. So our tests are at least catching some of the problems. Okay. So I'd like to review the rules of test room development. We don't have any markers, so I'm not going to be use that board. Does anybody know the three rules of test room development? Red, green, refactor. Those are the three steps, but I'm thinking about Uncle Bob's three rules of test room development. What's the first thing you should do when you're doing test room development? Yes, so you should write a test. All right, which fails? So how much test should you write? One test, yes? The first failing test, yes. So you should only write enough tests to go to red, only enough of the tests to go to red. And when you've written a failing test, what should be your next step? Make it successful, so that's the third step. And how much code should you write? Exactly. So you start with a test, you only write enough tests to make it go red, and only enough code then to make it go green. Now, if you'd only follow these three rules, you might be left with a mess on your hands. So what do we do in order to avoid the mess?
Refactor,
right. And when do we refactor? When we're on green. So that's the 3+1 is, so start with tests. Only enough tests to fail, only enough code to make it pass. Refactor, what do we refactor? The code and the test, yes. Good. And I like to add a step number 0 before those steps. So what should we do before we start writing the first test? It's a tricky one. What do we do before we write the first test? Think of something, yeah. Yes. So the first step is to think. The second step is to write a test. The third step is to only make enough tests to make it pass, only enough sort of fail, only enough code to make it pass, and then refactor. Shall we look at a problem that you guys could be solving? So I think that this is probably more simple than we need to do now. So we'll work on a little bit of a more difficult problem. So who knows Roman numerals? Roman numerals, yes. Let's write a function that takes a number and returns the number, a Roman numeral. All right, so what would be a good first test case? So now we're on the thinking step, we're thinking together. What's a good test case number one?
One,
yes. And what should one return?
I,
yes, good. What would be a good second test case?
Two,
and what should two return? All right. I think you're getting the hang of it. And what's a good number, test case number three?
Four,
possibly. It depends on how you implemented two. So if you implement number two with a loop, then number four is good. If you implemented number two with an if test, then three, right. So we've covered some of the Roman numerals. So what is five?
V,
okay. And what is, let's say, what's 10?
X.
X, all right. And what is 1999?
Local X is
X. Yes, something like that. So 1999 is MCMXCIX. And some scholars wonder why the Roman Empire crumbled. Yeah. So. All right. So you guys understand the problem, and I think you understand the approach. So remember, start with a test. Only enough test to go to red, and only enough code to go to green. So this covers the TDD part. What was the other practice that we're going to do today? Pair programming. Okay, so you need a pair. All right. So I have. Let's see. Who's in Java? Working in JavaScript. You're working in JavaScript, and you're working in JavaScript as well.
Yeah.
Good. Who's working in Java? Three people or so. Who's working in C Sharp? All right. So look around a little. Who's working in Ruby? And what else? What other programming languages have we not covered? Anything who wants to do something else? No? All right. So there's two rules for forming a pair. Find someone who wants to program in the same programming language as you. That's the first rule. And the second rule is find someone that you don't know already. So find someone that you haven't met before. And then get to it. All right. It would be helpful if you guys stand up. So until you found someone, stand up. And then when you found someone, you can sit down. So if there is someone who's not comfortable programming, you can go together with someone who feels like they don't need such an active partner, or you can go together with a group of two people already. All right, so now we will be walking around and help. Yes. Hold up a hand if you need help with setting up your environment to run tests. All right. Well, that doesn't sound like it has much to do with Mocha itself. Sometimes it's worth just trying. So you're comfortable with Jasmine? Right, so, and you have it installed as well? So Jasmine or Mocha would both be okay. So my preferred one is Mocha, but if you have something that's worked, then use that. Yeah, so you probably won't be needing Spice and Mocks for Roman numerals. But so if you're comfortable with it, please use that. All right, so you just arrived? All right, so what's your favorite programming language? JavaScript? You also want to program in JavaScript, Tishan? So do you have a computer with you? All right, but you got... Yeah, I think there's power supply over on this end here. So you can join up with Tishan. He'll catch you up with what's going on. All right, a good tip is to to start writing the first test up until probably 5 before you start looking too much into the whole thing of it, so that you have some tests that are starting to run and you know what questions to ask. Before you've written the first test, you probably will ask the wrong question if you try and look at Wikipedia. Wikipedia talks a lot about what happens after 4,000, which is crazy. No, 4,000, the number 4,000. The largest number that can be represented within the normal rules is 3,999, and after that, things go crazy. All right, so do you have a pair? All right, Aruna, how about you working together with, come again?
I can do
it. Yes, please. You're not joining him. You have to sit there. Yes, but that's no longer your problem. All right, so you're using Java? Yeah, it looks like you don't have the reference to the JVM. Have you configured the JVM on your... Well, that should be okay, as long as you got... right. Okay, so you guys, are you comfortable with Eclipse as well?
I'm comfortable with Eclipse.
All right, what about you? There is Eclipse here as well. So you could try that to see if it's... I've always had bad luck with IntelliJ. It's sort of the opposite of my lucky charm. I don't know why. All right. Well, if you haven't used IntelliJ either? All right, so then obviously IntelliJ is not the right tool for you guys. Yeah. So do you have... do you know how to set up the task environment with Eclipse? How to write your first task?
No, just have to inject the images or something.
Yeah, so.
Project,
yep.
Test project,
so. Normal Java project is usually just as well. So you got here. Where is it? Yes. And actually, the easiest way to do that now is if you write a new class. No, you've just added class. So, and call that. So, what's... Yes. So, what do you want to call the first test class? Yep. Front Roman test. Fine for now. And here's a nice trick with Eclipse. So when you get it open, so write test inside of the class body with a capital T. Capital T. Control space. Oh, I think this is control. I think he remapped it. There, okay. And then, yep, this one. Enter. So the kind of interesting way to do this is when you do it, like, so this is there. So the indentation is correct here. Control space, enter. And then you write a name for the task. So here, now you've got a compilation error here. So if you go to that line with a compilation error, you can do control. So the way to do it, you go there. No. Yeah, that's not the one. And there you got it. So if you're also using the keyboard shortcuts, that takes about 10 seconds. All right, so now you've got the first test method in place, and I think you got everything you need if you know how to write an assert. You got the first one to pass?
Yeah.
Cool. So, and now you're working on...
Right.
Yes, I think so. All right, so, yeah, you're... okay. All right, who's got a green test passed? All right, do you guys remember the step that Buddhima and I forgot?
High five.
High five, yes. I want to see more. Did you high five?
Yes.
Ah, great. yes. Okay, yes. So that's an improvement point. Good. Yeah.
So
you guys want to join? What about you? All right, you should make the test fail before you start writing code. So actually, yeah, you could do it that way as well. So what is your problem? Oh yeah, you need an insertion. So actually, these are static imports, and they got deleted when we did when we saved, because it had cleanup imports. Assert control dot assert equals like this. That's all that you need. All right, so then you call something here. So if you're stuck with something basic like how to get your test to run, then raise a hand. Probably will take a long time to learn everything about testing on the internet before we started. Don't overdo your design now. Nah, do one case at a time. Yes, until you see a pattern, just do one case at a time. So, biggest mistake that people do when they try and learn or try and apply TDD is to take too big steps. The key is to take as small steps as possible. No, it will take longer if you take bigger steps. In the short run as well, because. All right, that sounds good. Now, when you're doing that, so that will get the test to pass very fast if you just do the if test. And then you actually need one of them to be an else instead of an else if. That should pass the test. So, and now the important step is the refactoring. So now it's green, now you can refactor. So this approach that you have here, it doesn't seem like it's really doing what you're, I mean, we're not facing the problem like we're supposed to, right? So we're you're probably supposed to build up the return value and then return it somehow, right? So then you can change that to do that, but only for those cases. So that would be probably introducing a local variable. Ooh, you should keep the code there until you have something new working. You should try and find a small place to refactor between each test case. Between each test case, take a quick check and say, okay, is it okay, or should we do something to refactor now? Generally, the person who made the test pass is the natural person to start with the refactoring, but it's something that's you can go a bit back and forth on. Yes, good. That looks good. And now the question is, what's the simplest thing that could possibly work? So your partner should now make it pass, right? And see how fast you can make it pass. Just make it pass without thinking about how you're doing it, and then refactor. All right, you skipped two. Do you see why that's going to be impacting your design in a negative way? So 2 doesn't really fit into the pattern that you made. You took too fast, you didn't take enough small steps. Because that pattern will not look so good for 2 and 3, I think. Step? Refactor, okay. What would you like to refactor in the current code? No, that's but you don't have a test that indicates that. That wouldn't be a refactoring. That would be a design change. Yes. Yes. So what's a good test number 2? Good. I gave you a little bit of a hint there. Would you like to join? All right. Well, you didn't implement it correctly. So the copy-paste design pattern can help, but it requires, but it's very helpful to have a pair programming partner to help spot. You also need to change the output.
Yes.
All right. All right, so now remember that the person who was writing the test then passes the keyboard to the other person to make the test pass. And now when you're in the state of red, you should be afraid of red. So get to green as fast as possible and then start thinking. So when the code is red, don't try and think too much. Get to safe place and then think. More testing, less talking. Yeah, you will not get more comfortable by asking questions. You'll be more comfortable by seeing more code. So, well, that's only one way to find out. Yes. No, just go on. Just the simplest thing that could possibly work. Now your code deals. So your code has sort of, yeah, run the test, check it. It should pass now. Now, this is kind of redundant because you got these tests are sort of trying to do the same thing, right? So is it natural to check for high numbers first or low numbers first? Yeah, exactly.
No, but I don't think it's redundant because this for loop.
So just to.
I see.
Right.
So if it is four, we already have a decision.
Okay.
So why go further ahead?
Yes.
Okay.
So now, yes, you can run it. Yeah, there is like this and. This should kind of work, but it doesn't.
I use a shortcut here.
Yeah. You have to.
I have Android, it gives me
right, yes. Good. That's good. All right. So that, as you see, that passes. But you probably shouldn't do it because here you're checking. So now you're checking first for low numbers and then for high numbers. Right? So what's the natural? Is that the natural order, or would it be better to check for high numbers first and then for low numbers? Which one will exclude the other? Yeah. We've been going for 1 hour. How long do we have? Do anyone remember? Until five? So half an hour. All right. So now, how many got to, let's say, thousands? All right. You're at four. All right. So how many got past four? All right. And for those of you who did, how many of you had the I repeat in 1, 2, and 3? So how many of you hard coded 1, 2, and 3 as or hard coded 3 as III? All right. Yes. Yes. First time, but you did the refactoring, right? So. Yes, good. I'm very proud of you for saying that you did. That's the first step to fixing your problem is admitting that you have one. All right, so if you continued from 3 with III, you didn't refactor fast enough. Now, I thought that what we could do here is to have a... to have a little bit of a demo and reflection, and then to spend the last 15 minutes or so doing it again. So the key is to doing it well is to repeat. Who would like to help me to do a bit of a demo? I think C sharp. Yes, we'll do C sharp. All right. Who's a C-sharp programmer? All right. Would you like to help me with the demo?
But I lost everything last week.
Come again?
That
makes it even better. All right. I don't trust... test. So would you like to come up? Yes. Test project. I'm just going to make a simple unit test problem. Come on. It's a very cute solution, the one that you've got. All right, so we got this working for us. So shall we rename it, perhaps?
Yeah.
What's a good name?
My good name? Or?
Yes. All right.
Convert to Roman test.
Convert to Roman test.
Yeah.
All right, and what should be our first test method?
Should we write the test case and the argument? Or
No. Let's do the simplest thing.
Yeah.
Should convert one?
Yeah.
All right. And then for now, we can just do something local. So we say assert dot r equal. So it should be I, right? And then a to Roman of one. Oops.
To Roman of one, yeah.
And I'll make it compile. And this should be a string.
String.
And then I'll run it. All right. So build succeeded, and the test runner is a bit slow. Should convert one. Yes. All right. So what's the simplest thing that could get this test to pass, Vinay?
Yeah. So simplest thing is I check whether p is one, and if it is one, I'll return.
What's even simpler than checking if this one? Just return one. Yes.
Yeah.
Do it.
Okay.
More code, less think. So, come again? On red, code and not think. On green, think. So, your instinct should be, okay, the code is red. The first thing we need to do is to get to a safe place. That's the green place.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. And I think if you probably noticed that if you haven't done pair programming before, you probably noticed that it, you can press run all here. You probably noticed that it's a little bit nerve-wracking to, high five.
Hi.
It's a little bit nerve-wracking to pair programming. It's really much worse what Evina is doing now, standing on stage here. All right, so it's your turn to implement the next, or to write the next test. What's a good test number two?
Convert to two.
Yes. So copy paste that one.
Yeah.
And yes. That's it. Convert to I and to Roman. So so one of the things that control R A. So yeah. So let go of the control. So control R A, like this.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Good. So one of the things that you learn when you write a lot of tests is that the place to start is at the top of your method. So what's the simplest thing I can do at the top of my method now?
Return.
If p equals 2, return II. That's the simplest thing that will make the test pass. Now. That's probably the simplest thing. It's at least very simple. Now, is there any repetition in my code?
Return,
that could be a repetition. I think that you're right. I think that we should have a local variable here. So we could call it Roman, and that's, so we can do this, and then we say Roman plus equals, and this is kind of interesting. All right, so Roman. So that's, all right. Now there is kind of a.
You just repeated, it should be one, right?
Yes, thank you. Thank you for good programming there. All right, so now the repetition is even, is quite obvious. So what if I say, so if it's greater than one, we add one. And if it's greater than 2, then add 1 again. At this point in time, I could use a for loop. I think that that's simpler than what I've got now. But there is sort of a thing that... So this is a nice trick. So we'll do p minus equals 1 here. And then we can do the for loop. So that should pass still. All right. I'll leave the next refactoring for you. What's the next test I should write?
5.
What's before 5?
3.
Okay, so 3. Will 3 pass? All right. So I'll try. So nobody could give me a definite answer for whether 3 would pass or fail. I'll try it. That's the simplest thing, is to see, okay, it passes. So that means that, I don't really need it. I can skip it. But it was good that I wrote it, because now I have, then I can do, then I know that it's passing, and I can continue. All right, what's the simplest thing that V and I can do now to make it pass?
So if it is 4, then return 4.
Brilliant. I love it. It is the least amount of thinking while the code is read, and then we can start thinking. All right, so you need the semicolon before the curly. Your keyboard skills go down when you're programming in front of a crowd. Yeah, so control R and then let go of control and then A. Good. It's one of the best, one benefit to pair programming is learning shortcuts like that. Ah, high five. All right. So we did one refactoring with looking at a logic. I would like to think of another refactoring. So what's the simplest refactoring out there? What's the first step to get assigned? Yeah?
Rename method.
Rename. Or not necessarily method. What can we rename? What should we rename? Variables. Which variables? What? P. P is a horrible name.
Yeah.
What's a better name?
P is the number.
Yes. I like it. We'll do that. There is a shortcut, and there is also one thing. I often did the shortcut. I often stopped people doing it this way because I knew the shortcut, but there's two shortcuts. And now you just learned another one if you only knew the one. All right, so what about the logic now? How do you feel about it?
Yeah, so if it is above 3,
mm-hmm.
More than 3, then the V comes into picture.
Right, but I'm just talking about the structure now.
Yeah.
So this is kind of a different structure. Are we comfortable with that, or should we do something about it? What do you think? So in this case, we do a return here. Here we do the return at the end.
End, okay.
Should we try and make it always return at the end?
So what we can do is, like, this is Roman is equal to IV.
Yeah.
Sorry, and...
And then we need it to, need it to close the quote.
Yeah.
And then now what will happen is it'll add these. So we have to reduce it by 4. So we have to set it to 0 so it doesn't do that.
So
number, that should work. Now I don't like the curlies here. Can you put them so that they're consistent with the... Yeah. Nice. All right. I think that's starting to look good. Next test.
Mm-hmm.
It's your test. What's the next number that will not pass?
5.
All right. All right. Given the code that we have, can anyone say what's the simplest way that I can make 5 pass?
Hard code.
And... is there anything that I can use as a template for how to hard code it? Right. So I'll use that as a hard code template. So now when we're So I'm allowing myself to copy and paste code here. But I'm also noticing it when it happens that that is probably a situation where we should refactor. So this, and now we got these things here that's identical. So what should we do when we have like a block like this? What's the refactoring? Extract method. So convert Roman symbol. So here I need this to be a parameter and this to be a parameter. If I had ReSharper, it would help me do this, but Visual Studio in itself doesn't. So this is the string symbol, and this is the value of that symbol. So we say value, and we say symbol. Right. So that hopefully passes the 144. Yep, and then I can add 5 here as well. So now it's starting to look like it's some code with a little bit of structure. What's the next test that will fail? 6. This one is a bit trickier. So what's the simplest way to get it to pass? Here we can, there are a few different approaches here. So let's look at why it fails. It says, why do you think it fails, Vinay?
Because in this case, it needs I, and we have not considered that case. We are only...
So we're not considering when it's larger than 5. Yeah, so change it here, maybe?
Yeah.
So we can say if the number is greater than or equal to the value. All right, try and run that, see what happens. So sometimes you're kind of at a loss for what's going on, and then, okay, it gives us V.
Yeah.
Why does it give us V? Does anyone see? What happens there? Which line is the problem on? Come again?
The greater than?
The greater than, well, that's what kind of triggers the behavior, but we want the V to come out there, but then we want something more. So why isn't there more coming out?
So we should put 1 in that case so that it will also pick up one letter and take the...
Well, yes, we need to do that. But so here we're doing something weird.
Yeah.
This isn't good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we make it minus value. So then we take out those 5 from the Roman number.
Here, like this?
Yes. All right. Ah, good job. Any refactoring? I think we're good. All right, what's the next test? 7, 8, so 7 and 8, will they pass?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we're pretty confident that they will pass. 9, I guess, is the next one then.
Yeah.
All right, do you want to do 9?
Yeah.
All right, so how should I implement 9? So so 9 is just like 4. So that means that we've got it almost covered. We just need a duplication of that one. So control R A. And that's one of the hardest keyboard shortcuts to learn in Visual Studio if you haven't done it before. So very good job for learning it. So we said let's just copy this one. So that's IX and 9. That is interesting. Very interesting. Good. Okay, so what's the next one that will fail? And this is a little bit tricky, I think. 10. Oh, that's not tricky at all. Okay, I think you've got an easy job now.
So what is true for 4 and 5?
Yes, I think so. So you can just duplicate that one for 10. So a good way to do that, if you're not selecting anything, Control-C, Control, yeah. So if you're not, if you don't have anything selected, control C, control V, and I think you want the 10 before the 9. yes. All right. Okay, and now maybe a little bit tricky. What's the next one that will fail? So 10 passes. We're pretty happy with the 14. Cone. 14. So let's try that. Okay. So 14 should be. So why would 14 fail?
I'm just guessing.
Yeah. I think you're right, and I think it's too bad that you're guessing, because if you weren't, it would be very perceptive.
Because there are three numbers that will come into picture.
And 14. Yeah.
Three letters.
All right. So it does fail, and it does fail because it's 4. Which line is to blame? This one. All right. So this is pretty beautiful, isn't it? This here says take stuff out of the number. Come again?
Yeah.
So this moves stuff from the number and into the Roman. So that's very harmonious. Those two lines, they look good together. They're a perfect couple. All right, what's the next number?
I didn't understand, so I would like to mentally run through it. So that with the value. So if
it's just replace that value, actually. Instead of x, I, y, v,
you
just put the another value. So if you add this there, it'll be better.
Yeah, I got it now.
Yeah, so we probably could have seen that right away, because it wasn't quite harmonious the way it was. But that's fine. All right, what's the next value that will fail?
Continue.
20. Yes.
XX it would be.
And that will be the last one, I think, that we will do now. Thank you. 20. And, that's why copy pasting isn't always so good. All right, so what will it do? Does anyone want to guess? What will it say? X, and then I think it'll say XVIVI. XI. Who knows why? So what? I don't know what's going on there.
So I think it put X, 9, and 1. So it put X, 9, and 1.
Right. So it's 1 plus 9 plus 1.
Yes.
So it's doing it kind of correctly. It's just, it's
Roman. It's not Roman way.
Exactly. All right. So can anyone see what we need to do to fix it? So what's the problem? What are we not doing correctly in the case of the axis?
What happened for the 2?
Right. We need to repeat the X.
Yeah.
He said it.
Yeah.
Here we're only checking once.
Yeah.
How can we check more than once?
Why?
Yes. Go for it.
I think we did something here.
Yes. So that smells like a refactoring should be coming up. High five. All right, and like you said, this is the same.
Same.
So, yeah, so do you want to replace this loop with another call to convert? So if you do that before the loop.
Shall I remove that again?
I'll start by adding the other one.
Yeah. And I'll put 1 here.
So this is a good way to make sure that we're not moving very far away from the safe path. This probably should work, so try and run the test.
I should comment, right?
Right, let's do this. So we run it like this. And it's running, and it passes. Then we can delete it. Then we run it again. because it already ate up all everything, so that loop was not executed. High five. All right, so is this starting to look like something having to do with converting Roman numerals? All right, we've got about 10 minutes left. Would you guys like to try again what you did?
But we did it together, right?
Yeah. But you didn't do it with your hands.
Yeah.
So see how far you can get with this in 10 minutes, and I'm going to ask you to stay 5 minutes over time so we can do a quick wrap-up of what you learned. All right, so 10 minutes of delete your code and start over again.
Can we extend it up to 50 and 100?
Now here? Huh? Don't you have someone to pair with down there? Thanks. It's your laptops, so that I know I have your attention. All right, thank you. So close your laptop, but you can continue afterwards if you want to. And we'll have just a few questions. So, all right. So what's one thing that surprised you about the last 1.5 hour? Did you? Ah, no debugging. So who fired up the debugger? You did? No? So none of you debugged. That's interesting. So that's a success, I think. Okay, so what surprised you?
Small steps, sometimes they're not small enough. So you have to think through and just make it more smaller.
Right. So small steps are off. So you have to make the steps even smaller. Smaller steps, less you move faster. All right. What's one thing that you learned? Yeah, sure. I was pointing behind you, but we'll do you afterwards. Yes. What's one thing you learned?
If I were doing it, I would have written a bunch of tests, a lot of tests, and then I would have started it. But now it seems a different way of doing it, a different way of thinking.
Perfect. So a different way of thinking about the task. So to do one test at a time. I don't think that it's necessarily the only way or the right way, but it's very useful to learn this way in addition to your own way. So what did you learn?
I learned a new way to solve
algorithms. That's always good. We always need more Roman numeral solvers out there. All right. Vinay, what's one thing that you all that you plan to do differently when you return to work?
I would like to try this approach when I write code.
So you're talking about the TDD approach?
The pair programming, the first thing, and the second thing, going short
way. So Vinay would like to try the pair programming and the TDD. And I would really love it if you would write me an email telling me how it went. So who else wants to try pair programming and TDD with small steps when they return? All right. I would really appreciate if you send me email on this. You find my email address at the at here. Oh, no, not here, but here. And on the conference program. Please tell me how it went. Please ask for help if there's anything I can do. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope that it will help change the way you work. Thank you. And I'm sorry for stealing 3 minutes of your time.